bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless his holy name. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless his holy name.
You can tell it's December again, the Christmas traffic, the long lines at Dillard's, and all the Christmas parties you could imagine. It seems like every year, December gets here a little quicker, and it seems a little busier than the year before. Every household has their own set of holiday traditions, and ours is no different. My job is to get the tree. It's up to my girls to decorate it and make everything look good. But we've tried through the years to not let the decorations, the shopping, and the busy pace overshadow what the season is really all about. It's the story. The story of hope that brings us back to the manger year after year.
All right, girls. This tree should be the last thing we need to get this place looking like Christmas.
Are we talking Christmas or Christmas Christmas?
Talking this place has to be up to the Brother Gary's standard of Christmas.
Well, Mom, I guess that means another trip to Hobby Lobby.
Definitely.
Okay, this is the last box of decorations.
Depend on me. snow and mistletoe and presents on the tree. Christmas Eve will find me where the love light gleams. I'll be home for Christmas, if only in my dreams, if only in my dreams.
One of my favorite things about Christmas is this old handmade nativity scene that we've had for as long as I can remember. I've always thought it would have been interesting to meet whoever carved it. I feel like they must have been a Christian. There's something about it, you can just tell. The way the eyes look so gentle, the extra effort put into even the smallest details. It can't help but make you think of how it was for God to see the Son He had shaped and molded into perfection wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.
Hey, Natalie, how's that nativity scene coming along?
Is it gold, frankincense, and myrrh, or myrrh, frankincense, and gold?
You know, sis, I think the Lord will forgive you if you get it wrong.
Now this is Christmas. How long have we had this?
Don't you remember? We got it the first year we were married. I found it at a yard sale, and there was something so special about it, I just had to have it.
That's the only thing special she's ever found at a yard sale.
Doesn't it just remind you of all the details that God put into that night?
Christmas, Lord, is all.
When I think about Christmas, it's hard not to think about family. If I could ask for anything in the world, it would be for God to restore the family. For a long time, I carried a heavy burden for someone in my own family. When we were younger, Corey and I were not only brothers, but also best friends. You know, we were raised in the same house. We sat in Brother Jerry's junior high Sunday school class, even went on to the same summer mission trips. I know it's hard to believe, but we even used to argue over who got to read the Christmas story on Christmas Eve. I'm not really sure when it happened, but somewhere along the way, things just seemed to change. When it came to a relationship with Christ, Corey and I could not have chosen two more different journeys. That Christmas, like everyone before, my prayer was the same. Lord, I bring my family to the manger and lay them at your feet.
Peace.
Well, it looks like they'll be getting cold for Christmas. There's only 1 week until Christmas and still 3 weeks worth of things left to do.
How much more shopping can you do?
The shopping is the only thing I have finished. As a matter of fact, would you like to see what you got your parents?
I'm sure I did just fine. Hey, it's Corey.
Really?
Well, hey there, Corey.
Hey, man. Hadn't talked to you guys in a while and wanted to check on you and the girls.
Oh, yeah, we're doing great. You know, been real busy trying to get Christmas ready around here.
Oh, please.
How are Brooklyn and Emily?
Well, we've made some progress here lately. Hey, man, the reason I was calling, I wanted to do something with the girls for Christmas this year and was wondering if we could come over to your guys' house for a Christmas Eve dinner like we used to.
Absolutely. You're always welcome here. We'll be having dinner on Christmas Eve around 6 o'clock, just like always.
Awesome. Well, I guess we'll see you guys then.
All right. We'll see you.
Well, this should be interesting.
It has been a few years. Maybe Corey and Emily realize the importance of family, especially at Christmas time.
You know, girls, your grandmother used to tell me that Christmas was the story of Lot. I used to think that meant tree lots. She would say the wise men followed it, the shepherds experienced it, and we are called to walk in it. This will be our opportunity to show that light to our family.
Messiah has come to dwell.
Okay, the table's set, the turkey's in the oven, the presents are wrapped. What am I forgetting? Ice. Brandon, did you remember the ice?
Yes, ma'am. It's in the freezer.
Okay.
Are you okay? You seem a little stressed.
That would be an understatement. I just want everything to be perfect tonight. We have no idea what to expect.
Everything is going to be fine. Just in case, though, let's keep the sharp utensils away from Corey and Emily.
You're terrible.
Are you ready? Hey, guys, how's it going?
How's it going?
It's been nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, too.
Hello.
Hey, y'all come on in.
Hey, good.
Come on in.
Well, Jackie? Brooklyn has talked all the way here and all week about seeing your girls. Do you
want
to go see them
about
too?
Come on.
Looks like you guys hired Brother Gary to come over and decorate.
You know how my girls are. They love Christmas.
Yes, sir. It sure has been a while.
Yeah, it sure has. It's good to see you again.
It's good to be back.
So, what's the story?
Well, Brandon, there's not really a story, at least not yet. You know, I couldn't take being lonely at Christmas this year. We've had a little bit of progress, and I've been able to talk to Brooklyn on the phone a few times. But I guess Emily does have every reason to believe that I haven't really changed.
Well, don't take this the wrong way. But have you changed?
Man, I'm trying my best. It's just so hard. You know, I look around and I see all these families who seem to have it all together and everything seems to go perfect for them. And then I look back at my relationship with Emily and I've seen how I've just messed it up and ran it into the ground. Do you guys ever realize how lucky you are?
You know, Corey, it doesn't have anything to do with luck. On my own strength, we're not all that different. You know, when we were younger and my relationship with Jesus began, he filled that loneliness that you're describing. He changed me. And yes, that made me want to change my actions, but he changed my heart. So you wanting to do better for your family is great, but it'll take more than just determination. You're going to have to change on the inside, and that's something that only God can do. You know, loving God is the best thing that you can do for Emily and Brooklyn.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. It just seems like from the time that we were little kids, everything always came so easy for you. You always did the right thing. Looking back, do you realize how many times I wished I were more like you?
Well, I'm not perfect. You know, I have to deny myself daily. The Bible says in Hebrews that Jesus endured every type of temptation so that when we're tempted, he'll be there for us. You know, he can change every part of your life. You don't have to be held captive to your past.
A family hiding from the storm found no place at the keeper's door. It was for this a child was born, to save a world so cold and hollow. The sleeping town, they did not know that lying in a manger low, a Savior King who had no home has come to heal our sorrows. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God to write his story?
Shepherds counting sheep at night, do not fear the glory light. You are precious in his sight. God has come to raise the lowly.
Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? It may set you apart when you make room in your heart and trade your dreams for his glory. Make room in your heart. Make room in your heart. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God to write his story? You can come as you are. It may set you apart when you make room and trade your dreams for his glory. Make room in your heart. make room in your heart. Make room in your
Dad, we were thinking now might be a good time to read the Christmas story.
Yeah, sounds good. Find it here in Luke. You know, Corey, why don't you read it this year?
Are you sure about that?
Absolutely.
That's Luke chapter 2?
Chapter 2.
You know, after all those years of reading it with Mom and Dad every year at Christmas time, you'd think I'd know that by now. See, Luke chapter 2. And at that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for the census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, his fiancée, who was now obviously pregnant. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn child, a son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no room available for them. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. And they were terrified. But the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David." This may be a strange time to ask this question, but why do we read this story year after year after year?
Well, it gives us an opportunity to fix our eyes on Jesus. You know, he's the author and the finisher of our faith. Christmas wouldn't mean a thing if we didn't give credit to him. I knew then that God had answered my prayer. From that moment on, the Lord began to restore every bit of brokenness in our family. This is a story of hope, a reminder of the Savior's mercy. He came as a baby in a manger, yet he lives in the hearts of all who seek him. It's heaven's way of bringing Christmas home.
Jesus pulled me out. I'm no longer bound. am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am.
There is a new day. I said, if he's changed your life this evening, I said, if he's changed your life this evening, rewritten your story, then surely we can give him a hand clap of praise in this house this evening. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe you're here tonight, and for some reason along the way, you've lost your way. How many of you know that that's possible? We get started out right. As the story goes here that you've heard tonight, we get started out right, and life just happens. And the enemy takes advantage of difficult situations in all of our lives. From poverty to sickness to whatever it may be. And maybe somehow, somewhere along the way, you're here tonight and you've gotten off track. And God brought you by Van Buren First Assembly tonight so that you can get back on track. You were invited by a family member, or you saw it on our sign, or maybe you're watching us somewhere around the world this evening. The Lord brought you to this moment in time. Trust me this evening. The Lord brought you to this moment in time to tell you during this season that He loves you and He cares for you. It's not about what you've done. It's not about what even got you off track to begin with. He brought you here tonight to get you back on track. And that so you can meet the author of your story. The question is this evening, sir. The question is this evening, ma'am. Is there room in your heart for Him? Is there room in your heart this evening to allow Him to get you back on track? If I were to hand this microphone to each person in the building this evening, we could all tell of stories of unexpected things that have happened in our lives. Financial reversals, death, disease. We could all tell stories of how the enemy has just defeated us along the way. But God Himself brought you here tonight. Yes. To tell you that it's more than a story. I preached it this morning. It's more than talking about a baby in a manger. And it's more than talking about a Christ in a tomb or a Jesus on a cross. Tonight He is very much alive and He is very much in love with you. And He wants to be the author of the rest of your story. So how do I go about that, preacher? How do I make that happen? Nothing else has seemed to work, right? Bankers, it doesn't get you out of financial trouble. Doctors, don't you get you out of where you're at. Lawyers can't get you out. Well, I want to tell you tonight, there is a man named Jesus that can get you out of all of those things. But the question is to you, is there room in your heart for Him tonight? Would you bow your head with me? And as these folks prepare to sing this song one more time, and we're going to take some pictures, we're so glad you came. Nobody's looking around, but tonight we did every bit. They sang every song, every word. They did everything tonight for you to bring us to this moment of decision. The greatest gift you may get under a tree in the next few days is not a greater gift than the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. You cannot receive anything in this natural world, anything greater than the gift of salvation and knowing that your life is right with Jesus Christ. Nothing better. So this evening, maybe you've gotten off track, and you know what? That's okay, because I'm the pastor of this church and I've been off track in my life. Maybe somewhere there are some things going on in your life tonight and you would say, Pastor, if I were to tell you about this or that, you wouldn't believe it. Guess what? I don't need to know tonight what you're facing. God knows what you're facing. So for the next moment, I'm going to lead you in a prayer, and maybe you're off track, or you know what? Maybe you've never been on track. Maybe you've never lived your life for Jesus Christ. You know what? You can change that all tonight by repeating this simple prayer after me. I'd like everyone to say it. Would you say this? Dear Lord Jesus, I give myself to You, spirit, soul, and body. I recognize I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. Wash me in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Forgive me of all of my sin and help me to forgive myself. Help me to live from this day forward as you would have me to live. In Jesus' name, thank you for saving me. Thank you for cleansing me. Amen. While your head is still bowed, quickly, and then we'll move on. I'd just like to know, and I'm not going to take your picture. At most, I can't even see for all of the lights. But who would just be honest? No one's looking around. He would say, "Preacher, Pastor, I said that prayer tonight, and I meant it in my heart, and I need a fresh start. I've got to get back on track." If you just slip your hand up, let me see your hand across this sanctuary. Thank you. Somebody else. I got to get back on track. Come on, just slip your hand up. Let me see it real high. Don't be ashamed. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. 6, 7. Thank you. Thank you. I see your hand. Somebody else. Somebody else tonight. Thank you, ma'am. I see your hand. Praise God. Then tonight, listen, you can look up at me. Tonight is not in vain. Tonight, you came to hear singing, and what a wonderful job they did, and all the work they've, from the young folks to the older folks. But it was to bring you to a point of making a decision. If you don't have a home church, we would love to have you in this church. There's a place here for you. If you have a home church, then by all means, go back to your church. If you lifted your hand and you got yourself right tonight, then go back to your home church. Find your pastor and tell him what you did tonight. But if you don't have a place to attend, I'll tell you, this place will welcome you with open arms, just as Jesus did tonight. Would you give them a decision? 6 or 8 hands, I believe I counted tonight, that made. Now, there are 6 or 8 new names written down in glory. I said, they sang about it, and there's, so they're going to sing this song again. I'd like to ask if it's possible, if all the little kids, you would come back quickly. If you sang tonight and you can bring your mama, your daddy, or whatever you want, come back. We want to try to get the best picture we can, if possible. And then, if you'd like one of the poinsettias here, you say poinsettia, poinsettia. These red flowers sitting up here in front of you. We want you to have one. You can take it. Don't fight over them. If you don't get one and you need one, I'll go buy you one as soon as this is over. But we want to make sure everybody gets all the pictures that they want. As these folks are making their way up here and they're going to sing this song again, I just want to say from the staff of this church, from my family to you and yours, I pray that this is the best Christmas you've ever had. I pray that you have a Merry Christmas. I know we have a lot of folks that are already traveling and a number of folks that just don't feel well, but we're glad that you came out tonight. And I know there are difficult things going on all around in this world. Absolutely. All you got to do is watch 10 seconds of the news. They'll tell you how bad things are going. But everything is going according to God's plan. And He's in control. Amen. So from Van Buren First Assembly to your family, we hope you have a very Merry Christmas. And as they sing again, that'll be our dismissal. I want you to turn to somebody, shake their hand, greet them, then you can come confiscate your child when this is over. And we'll take pictures. And God bless you. Please remember there'll be no Wednesday night service this week. We'll see you back on Sunday morning. God bless you. Hey, before we go, I'm sorry. I just want to say thank you to a couple of people. Start playing, so I'll be quiet. I want to say thank you to Hannah Hathcock, to Cody Dunn, Cody Scott, all of our media team, to Parker Dunn, to Katie Mankins that led the choir, Miss Katie standing behind here. Thank you to my wife, Joni, for all the hard work, for all the work these kids have done. Would you give them a hand clap of praise and sing with them as we go? God bless you. Merry Christmas.